Phoenix, and welcome to the House of Mystery radio show. This is the place to come for true crime, conspiracy, and alternative history. Only on KFNX 1100 Independent Talk Radio. We're here every Saturday morning, 6 to 7 a.m., and I'm your host, Al Warren. Are back in the House of Mystery on KFNX Phoenix. Thank you for coming back and seeing us. Now, today we're continuing with more true crime, and we have an author with us named Monte Francis, and I caught on to his latest book, Ice and Bone, and it's The Tracking of an Alaskan Serial Killer. So, just in the title, it sounds kind of exciting to me. Thank you for taking time to talk to us, Monte.
Sure, thanks for having me.
This is fascinating. Now, this wasn't your first book either, was it? This is your second true crime book.
Yeah, I wrote a book in 2007 that was published by HarperCollins called By Their Father's Hand. It was a true story about a man in Fresno, California, who was convicted of murdering nine of his children. It was pretty a terrible story that I had covered as a TV reporter in Fresno. And ended up writing a book about it.
That must have been pretty hard, like, because if you're covering a story as a reporter, and it kind of, you follow it, it attracts you into writing a book, it must have been a hard sort of process to deal with, because doesn't it consume you all the time?
Yeah, it did. And I covered, not only was I there for the actual crime itself, like I was there the night that there was a domestic disturbance, and essentially what had happened in that story was that the family had this murder-suicide pact that if the government ever came to, you know, separate the family, that the older kids would kill the younger ones and then themselves, and this was all sort of taught to the kids from the time they were, you know, very little. And there was incest in the family and all this kind of stuff. So, you know, I was at the crime scene as they, you know, were announcing to us, you know, the death count was going up, you know, five people dead, seven people dead, nine people dead. And then they escorted the father out, you know, this overweight guy with very long dreadlocks, and he was covered in blood, you know, and he was the father of this family. It was pretty horrific. So, and I can remember doing live shots that night, and one of the other reporters I was with broke down in tears in the middle of her live shot because it was so overwhelming, you know. And then I covered that trial, which went on for, if I recall, it was like a three-month trial, and I was blogging about it from inside the courtroom. But I got permission from the judge to sort of blog the testimony, and people started following the blog, and that's kind of how I fell into writing a book about it. But interesting, you said, like, you know, how do you deal with these things when you're writing about them? The entire time I was covering that story, really from beginning to end, even the trial itself, I really didn't have, and it was a very disturbing story. I mean, very disturbing, because you had incest and murder, and he was playing all kinds of psychological games with his children and stuff. It didn't bother me while I was covering it, but then after it was done, like I finished the book and sort of put everything aside, that's when I started having nightmares about it. It was something, I think you do something psychologically as a reporter when you're covering something, you're able to like put up a wall in a way to sort of keep yourself separated from it so that you can be objective in reporting it. But you're also a human being, so at some point, that stuff starts to seep through, you know, and it starts to affect you in that way.
Yeah, I could imagine. Because I know I get that way on some of the stories I cover. And so your background was in reporting, right?
Yeah, and actually, I still report on television. I work for a television station here in the Bay Area, KTVU, the Fox affiliate. And I was with the NBC affiliate before that. So primarily, I was and still report on television, and then I write true crime. I shouldn't say on the side, because this last book took me, I basically took a year off and researched and wrote Ice and Bone. So I do both, write and report on television.
Yeah. What made you start writing the book? Like when you went to the very first book, even, was there something that made you want to write a book on true crime itself?
Well, honestly, the way that happened was, I'm told it never happens this way, but an agent approached me out of the blue. I guess they found out that I had written this blog that had become popular and asked if I would be interested in writing a book. And I hadn't even really considered it. And I had just finished my completed my MFA in creative writing at Fresno State time, and I was working at the TV station. And I decided that I would give it a try, that I would do it. And I started trying to write after, I would work, an 8-hour day, come home, and then try to write afterwards. And I quickly figured out, because the publisher had a deadline, that I was not going to meet the deadline. So I essentially, took the advance money. I quit my job as a TV reporter, moved to the Bay Area, and just started. And then for the next couple of months, finished that first book. I wrote it within, I think, 3 months or something. And that was kind of it. And so the first book, I just sort of fell into it, as they say. And then I really did enjoy the experience of writing the book, because you're able to delve into something in a much deeper way. And then so that was seven, let's see, that was 2007. So then last year, and I'd been wanting to write another book. I actually had written a proposal for one. It's a long story. That whole thing fell through. So I became discouraged about writing another book for a while. And finally, I sort of gained up the courage and desire to write another book. And when I found this story in Alaska.
Now, the new book, Ice and Bone, that's Tracking of an Alaskan Serial Killer. So you said you found that. How did you find that case?
Well, I was looking for another case to write about, and I knew that I wanted to do something with unsolved crimes. And I was also intrigued by Alaska. I'd never been there. I liked the idea of a story being set in such a desolate place. And so I was just sort of searching around in the archives, and came across this article in the Anchorage Daily News from 2000 that about the murders of six women who had all been killed within a relatively short time span. Like, well, I think it was 16 months. And five of them were native or were Alaskan natives, and one was African American. And at the time, they thought that a serial killer was on the loose. So I began by looking at, this was 2014 when I was looking at the article. I began by looking at which of these cases had been solved, all these years later. And I found out that three of them had been, sort of resolved, and then three were still unsolved. And the thing that intrigued me was one of the cases was a woman by the name of Della Brown, who was found beaten to death in a shed. And the killer in that case, or the person who had been, tried for her murder, was acquitted and had walked free. And then he went out and murdered another woman, totally separate from the first six. There was a trial in the Della Brown case, but in the second case, Mindy Schloss, the woman that he murdered, as a result of a plea deal in that case, he admitted that he had indeed killed Della Brown, even though he had been acquitted. And there was some suspicion as to whether or not he had killed these other women as well. So I found that to be intriguing, because these cases were still unresolved so many years later. And I called a woman by the name of Disa Jacobson. She was quoted in this newspaper article. She's a native an Alaska Native activist, and she had gone on a hunger strike because she was so upset about the verdict in the Della Brown case, and she felt there was not enough attention being paid to these unsolved cases involving Native women. And so I began talking to her, and she was really the one who ended up convincing me that this was a story worth telling. I mean, she's a very compelling personality.
So in general, what happened in the case, the basic points?
Well, so as I said, there were these six women who had been murdered. Della Brown was one of them. There was this big trial because Joshua Wade, who was this young, 20-year-old drug dealer, had basically confessed to his friends that he had killed her. He was kind of bragging. In fact, he brought some of them one by one to the shed to show them her body. And some of them ended up calling Crime Stoppers, to collect the money, the reward money. And all of that sort of led police to wire some of his friends. Secretly recorded police wire. And what they did was they took the newspaper article, that front page article, the same one that I had come across, that recounted the murders of these six women that had pictures of all of them on the front page of the local paper, and they planted this newspaper on the dashboard of the car. This is also a car the police had given to these two informants, we'll call them. And so when Joshua Wade gets into the car, he sees the newspaper article, and the idea was this would spark some kind of conversation, during which he would make some kind of confession. What ends up happening is he makes a comment, and he's profane, so I won't say exactly what he said, but he basically indicates there are three women on here that I killed. And one of the informants says to him, hey, what's up with you and Native women? And he says, well, not all of them are Native. She was black, referring to the only victim in the case who was black. So from that, it appears that he made this ostensible admission that he had killed three of the women. And but the thing was is that during the Della Brown case, the jury, they weren't allowed to hear evidence that indicated that he had killed anyone else besides that victim. So all that stuff was kind of edited out of the tape. So that was sort of the premise that I started the book with, because I was interested in finding out, did he indeed kill these other women? Why did it seem that attention was not being paid to these other cases? Was Deesa Jacobson right that law enforcement wasn't paying attention to these cases because they were Native Alaskan women? All of that I found intriguing, and I wanted to find out more. So that's why I decided to go to Alaska. I spent a month there kind of researching the case before I embarked on the actual writing of the book.
So that's really interesting. We covered a lot of the Highway of Tears murders, which you've probably heard about up in northern B.C., about Alaskan, or not Alaskan, but Native girls being, killed and gone missing, and the lack of, support from the police. Do you think that's the true case here as well, or?
Well, I mean, the thing I was just thinking about was, Deesa Jacobson said this to me too. I mean, the predators are aware that the law enforcement doesn't follow up on these cases. And if you just look at, the instance of rape among Alaska Native women, it's staggering. I mean, the statistics show it's, 12 times the national average in some of these villages. And many of these, when you're not in a large city like Juneau or Anchorage, many of those villages don't have road access, so it's, impossible to even get there in the wintertime, unless you're on a helicopter. Many of them don't have law enforcement. There's no way that these women can report sexual assault if it has indeed happened to them. So the ones that are reported are the ones that show up in the statistics. And so you have to assume that it's even worse than what the numbers say it is. And I heard someone say, and this is totally, you know, anecdotal, but that, you know, by a certain age, by, you know, preteen age, all Alaska Native women have been raped. Now, that's not been proven, but that's something that is said, you know, in the community. So if you just take that part and, you know, that issue of rape and how it's regarded, you can sort of extrapolate, yeah, predators see that that's a reality and that they could take advantage of it in various ways.
And do you think that it's also a lack of policing itself? Is there just not enough police officers up there?
Well, like, as I said, like, a lot of those villages don't have law enforcement. So there's not even really a way for people to report those cases. I mean, I guess you'd have to conceivably come to a city where you could talk to a police officer, you know? But, you know, like, for example, the village where Della Brown was from is called Shishmaref. It's, like, way up by the Bering Strait. In fact, it's you may have, I don't know if you've seen this on the internet, but it's this village that's, because of global warming and erosion, is kind of falling into the sea. So you'll see pictures of huts kind of dangling off cliffs, you know, falling into the water, and they've had to move people. Anyway, but it's very, very remote. I mean, so the idea that someone who's a victim of a crime could just walk down to the police station and report it, it just doesn't happen that way.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really too bad. So you actually lived there a month. How did you find people to respond to you? Because you're there writing a book about this. Were they pretty supportive and open to you?
Yeah, I mean, they were. I mean, the thing that I didn't realize before I went, this was just my own, you know, naivete. I went in November, which was,
ooh,
you know, I guess it didn't register to me that, like, that's the darkest time of year. So I got there, and there it was, like, dark the entire time. I think the sun came up for, like, an hour or something and then went back down. So after like 3 weeks there, I was starting to feel a little bit like crazy, like, wait, why is the sun not coming up? And I see why people, you know, I connected with a friend of mine, a mutual friend there who has kids, and they would sit at the breakfast table with those, you know, mood lights on.
Yeah.
Seasonal affective disorder is a big thing there. But yeah, so that was one thing that I didn't really think about before I went. But yeah, people were very open and friendly. I talked to a lot of the victims' family and friends. Della Brown's mother was very open and talked to me. I talked to like most of her siblings. The one thing I found to be a big challenge in doing research, because Della Brown's trial lasted for so long, it was like 3 months long. In the court system there, they don't have a court reporter in the courtroom that's like, you know, typing everything out. So they have an audio recording of what happened. And so the way you have to get a hold of transcripts, well, they're not really transcripts. You have to get a hold of the audio. They have these things called log notes, and then you have to order the different portions you want. And then I myself had to go through, listen to the tapes, and then transcribe them. It took me probably 2 months. You know, after I left Alaska, just to do that part of it, it was pretty tedious.
Wow, yeah, that would be crazy, crazy. Mm-hmm. What's the overall impression up there? How do they feel about this crime and other crimes toward Alaskan Native women? Is this sort of, do they look at it as a race issue?
I mean, it depends on who you talk to, of course. I mean, Tisa Jacobson, we became very, you know, we became friends, and when I was up there, we spent some time together. She took me down to, there's a place in Anchorage. It's sort of near the port of Anchorage, but it's where a lot of the homeless people camp out. And but keep in mind, this is Alaska in wintertime. It's like 18 degrees outside. People are like camped out in tents. You know, they build fires and stuff. And I had a rental car, and we drove down there, and she was pointing out to me all the homeless people, and she all of a sudden became very, like, agitated at the saying, these are the landowners, they're the landowners, and she was sort of exclaiming at them, sort of jumping up and down. And I didn't understand immediately what she meant, but then it dawned on me, oh, she's referring to the fact that almost all of these homeless people are Native people. And it enraged her to think like that these were the native people of the land, and here they were relegated to living out on the streets, and she found it very upsetting. I mean, as I said, it really depends on who you talk to as to whether they think there's a, you know, a big injustice against Native people. I mean, you can't, but when you look at the statistics and what's happening in the Native community, it's troubling. I mean, even if you look at the instance of, like, fetal alcohol syndrome, I mean, it's really, I mean, they've done something to correct, I think, that problem. But, you know, fetal alcohol syndrome, just so people don't know, it's a condition that results after a woman drinks during pregnancy, and it can result in a number of developmental problems for that person. And then the cycle continues, because then that child is more likely to be involved in crime and have problems and delinquency. And anyway, so the cycle, it's like a vicious cycle. But and at one point, it's not this way now, but at one point it was like 40% of the babies born in the Native community were at risk of having this syndrome. And I think that the state health officials have done a lot to correct it. But as I said, like it is a cycle, because a whole generation of people were affected by that.
Yeah, it's going to take some time. How were the police toward you?
Honestly, the police were not cooperative. The Anchorage police were not cooperative at all. I called them multiple times while I was there, spoke to their public information officer. Finally, I got the head of the homicide unit to agree to meet with me. I had this huge long list of questions, because I had all these questions about the unsolved cases. And he was very polite and he was nice, but he basically didn't tell me anything. He refused to answer any questions about even, like, in one of the cases, it was unclear how the woman had been killed, and he wouldn't even tell me that. I mean, these are cases that were, you know, 14 years old and had been cold. So, but the FBI, who became very much involved with the case after Mindy Schloss was murdered, and the federal prosecutors as well, were very cooperative and great. And I should also say that the lead detective in the Mindy Schloss case for the police, Pam Pernew, was very helpful to me. I want to point that out. She no longer works for the police department. She, in fact, works for the FBI. She lives in D.C., and I interviewed her in D.C. But she was great. She was absolutely great. But yeah, it was a challenge. It was a challenge trying to get information out of the police. And I still don't really know why that was. I did talk to, you know, one of the investigators in the Della Brown case, and he did not want to talk to me. I'm still not clear as to why, because he had said something about not wanting to offend the family. And I explained to him, well, I've interviewed the family and they've, you know, given their blessing to what I'm doing, and he still wouldn't talk to me. So I don't know what that was all about.
Yeah, kind of defensive. So now, what eventually happened to the killer? Like, did he actually get convicted in the end?
Yes, he did. There was a plea deal in the Mindy Schloss case, and he admitted that he had killed Mindy Schloss. So he was convicted of first-degree murder in that case and accepted a sentence of life without the possibility of parole. He also, at that sentencing, admitted that he had killed Della Brown. And then and he apologized and made this emotional statement. And then the judge started to kind of deliver his thoughts about the case. And he and Joshua Wade, all of a sudden, from this mood of being, you know, appearingly remorseful, got very angry, which is very characteristic of him. He had this very explosive temper. And because the judge called him a coward, and that really made him mad. So he didn't like the perception that he was only victimizing women. So he blurted out at the sentencing to the judge, what about all the men I killed? And the judge said, well, I don't know anything about the men you've killed. What are you talking about? And he said, well, don't make it seem like I've just killed women. I killed men, too, or something like that. And but that's what he left. That's kind of where he left it. And then many months later, when he was very upset that he was being kept in the prison system in Alaska, because obviously he was well-known, he was notorious, and the Native people who were in jail with him or in prison with him obviously didn't like the fact that he had victimized this Native woman. So he wanted to get out of Alaska. And so he admitted to these three additional murders. These were apparently the men to whom he was referring at the sentencing. And in exchange for admitting to those three additional murders, they moved him out of Alaska to a federal prison. Well, initially in Indiana, and then they moved to Pennsylvania, and he's now at a federal prison at Beaumont, Texas.
Did he have an actual MO to this? Like, was there a certain type of woman or man or certain way of killing? Was there something that he was looking for in the kill, or was it just for the fact of killing?
It's really difficult to say. I mean, so the first killing that he admitted to, he was only 14 years old, and the guy who he killed he wasn't homeless, because I think he lived at a halfway house or something like that, but he was a very harmless, defenseless guy, you know, who was just walking down the street. And I interviewed Joshua Wade's sister, and she told me her brother had told her a little bit about the circumstances surrounding this murder. And Wade said that the guy was trying to help him, actually, that he was, I don't know, trying to help him get something to eat or something like that, and that Joshua Wade was kind of creeped out by him, and so he decided to shoot him in the back of the head. So, you know, that was when he was 14 years old, if you can imagine. I mean, he was a very troubled kid. He had tried to commit suicide, you know, as a adolescent, and was institutionalized, you know, was a delinquent, had run-ins with the law at a young age. You know, it's hard to say if he had a certain kind of victim. So Joshua Wade's father, who I interviewed, seemed to think that his son has a fixation on, like, maternal figures. Because Bubba Wade, who is his father, told me that he thought that the victims all kind of looked similar, and that they also sort of looked like Joshua Wade's mother. They looked like his mother. I've looked at all the pictures. I'm not sure if that's actually true. I mean, I guess you could say that there are, like, basic characteristics that they all share, but to me, they didn't really look all that similar. So I think it's really difficult to say. I mean, Bubba Wade said his son just had an anger problem, and that probably explained the murders of the men. And as for the women, he thought it was like a fixation on maternal figures. I don't know if that's true or not.
Yeah, it's usually they have some sort of a, you know, something, you know, it's always the same kind of looking girl or man, and around the same age, and they do the same sort of thing, like stabbing or shooting or whatever. I was just wondering if he had some sort of pattern, I guess you'd want to call it the best. How was the family about the ending? The different families that you had talked to, were they feeling that justice was served on this?
You're talking about, like, any of the families, you mean?
Yeah, any of the ones that you actually got to talk to yourself.
I talked to many of them. So, I mean, obviously, Della Brown's family felt like justice was not served in the first trial, because he obviously was acquitted and sort of got away with it and then didn't admit to it till much later. Mindy Schloss wouldn't have been murdered had he been convicted during that first trial. So, and I dedicate a whole section of the book to sort of what went wrong in the trial. That's like a whole other story. But, I think that Mindy Schloss's friends, because she had she didn't have really close familial ties, but had very close friends. She was a nurse psychologist, and some of, like, her best friend who I interviewed. I think she was grateful that they didn't have to go through this long trial, because it's very traumatic to go through a trial. I mean, you, even Della Brown's mother, I mean, you have to endure, like, all the crime scene photos being shown and all this graphic testimony, and you have to, like, relive it, you know, over and over again. So I think they were grateful they didn't have to go through a trial. I mean, some of these unsolved cases, so there's I mentioned the African-American woman who was killed. I interviewed her, her husband, and then her daughter. Her daughter was only 14 at the time her mother was killed. And this had a really profound effect on her. And, like, all these years later, she still doesn't know, like, what happened. And she actually wrote to Joshua Wade in prison and asked him if he had anything to do with it, because she felt like, well, what do I have to lose? He's spending the rest of his life in prison. And he, you know, he didn't respond, which is, to me, not a surprise.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. How did this all leave you after going through this, going down to Alaska, spending your time there, flying all over, interviewing, doing all the transcribing of the audio? At the very end of it, and the book's finished and done, how has it changed you?
Wow, that's a good question. Well, I think I'm a lot more aware about what's happening up in Alaska. I mean, it's something, I'd never even been to Alaska before I embarked on this journey or this project. And it's a different world up there, you know? It's like culturally, I mean, there are ways in which it's very American, but then there are ways in which it's foreign as well to me. I mean, to me, as somebody who grew up in the Midwest and who's lived in California for the last 10 years. And I think I wasn't aware also, it was sort of an education for me too about sort of the history of discrimination against Native Alaskans and sort of what the situation is there now. And so I think that changed me. And, you know, anytime, and then also just, and I've written other stories that where you have to interview victims' families, and I'm always just amazed how resilient people can be who've experienced, like, the most horrible tragedies, you know, who've survived sort of the unthinkable. And that always sort of gives me hope, kind of in a human spirit, you know, that you can survive something so horrible and find a reason to move on, because it seems like sometimes that's not always possible.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. So who are your biggest influences and on your writing itself?
Well, you know, I have my MFA, I have a Master of Fine Arts in Creative Writing from Fresno State, and my MFA is actually in poetry. So, you know, Philip Levine was a big influence. He was involved in a program at Fresno State. Connie Hales, who's a poet, who was very influential for me. Mary Carr, who has written a number of memoirs, was at Syracuse University and taught the first writing workshop that I ever took. She was very influential. And when you talk about sort of like creative nonfiction and true crime, John Krakauer, I think, is amazing. I just read Missoula, which recounts sort of the rape scandal there. I think he's incredible. And then, of course, at Wild Blue Press, we have a number of really great true crime writers, Steve Jackson, who founded Wild Blue Press, and John Farrick, and a bunch of others are all doing really great work. One really great book I listened to, I was driving across country recently, I listened to the audiobook of The Looming Tower by Lawrence Wright. It won the Pulitzer Prize. It recounts sort of the road to 9/11, how we got there. I found that to be an amazing and important book, I thought. I mean, in terms of like creative nonfiction, to me, that's just, you can't get any better than that.
So where do you see yourself going now? Like, what's next?
Well, I continue to report here in the Bay Area. As I said, I work for a TV station here. And I haven't really thought about what my next like true crime project might be, but I plan to write another book. It's just, it'll depend upon like the story and if I feel like there's enough there for a book. You know, sometimes you come across a story and it's, and you think, oh, that would be a good like short story, not a short story, but you know, like a good article. And then, but I think it's rare when you come across a case where you're like, oh, this could be a book, you know? And so I think it's just a matter of finding that next case or that next story.
Yeah, you'll know when you see it, kind of, it'll have the right feel, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing. So how do people get a hold of you, and how would they contact you? What's your information?
Oh, well, you can go, I have a website, and it's just my name, Monte Francis, MonteFrancis.com. And there are links there to all my social media accounts, Facebook, Twitter, and all that stuff. On Twitter, I'm at Monte Reports with an S on the end of it. Yeah, that's how you can find me.
Well, fantastic. Well, I want to thank you for taking this time and talking about your new book and just about you.
Thanks so much for having me. I really enjoyed it. Thanks.
Show is over for now.
Was it as good for you as it was for me?
Well, good night.
This has been a production of the Z-Talk Radio Network.
I'll be back.